ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। हरि ओम। गणानान्त्वा गणपतिगुं हवामहे कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनश्रण्वन्नोतिभिः सीदसादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः। सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम्। ओम् आप्यायन्तु ममाङ्गानि। सर्वं ब्रह्मोपनिषदं माहं ब्रह्म निराकुर्याम् मामा ब्रह्म निराकरोत् अनिराकरणमस्त्व निराकरणं मे अस्तु। तदात्मनि निरतेय उपनिषत्सु धर्मास्ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु। ओम शांति शांति शांतिः। त इह व्याघ्रो वा सिंहो वा वृको वा वराहो वा कीटो वा पतंगो पतंगो वा दगुंशो वा मशको वा यद्यद् भवन्ति तदा भवन्ति। सो व्हेन ए गिवन जीवा एन इंडिविजुअल गोस इनटू स्लीप और डाइज अवे or even goes into the Mahapralaya, the final annihilation, big crunch, he will come back. He is bound to come back. Like even you have a pot with water put into the well with a rope tied to it. As long as there is a rope tied to the neck of the pot, it will come up. If the rope is not there, it will merge into the well. Forget about the pot, just the water inside the pot. The water inside the pot is the thing, you know. The physical body is nothing, the astral body we are talking about. Therefore, when you put this pot into the well, if there is a rope, then water will come up along with the rope. But there is no rope, suppose. That tying of that rope is removed, the tied rope is removed. Then what happens to that water? It won't come up again. It will merge into the source. Same way here, when the person, when an individual goes into sleep, he will come back. When he comes back, tadeva tada bhavanti is there, you know, mashakova yadyad bhavanti tada bhavanti. Whatever was their limitation or nature taken to be by the person by identification with the body and mind. That purusha prakruti sthohi bhunte prakruti jan gunan, you know. So, the purusha, he enters into the body, mind and senses and gets identified with them. And so, now there are a few limitations, you know. Body has limitations, mind has limitations, sense organs have their own limitations. And those limitations and a few habits also. Habits means vasanas. So, these limitations and habits put together, they are assumed to be one's own. They are not one's own, but they are assumed to be like that. Therefore, now this Purusha, he becomes as though having all those limitations and habits. That is what is called Jiva. There is no other Jiva than this. Except an assumption, there is no other Jiva. In fact, I tell you, suppose everything is like this in this world, just we don't care to look into it. Suppose an elected person, a mayor is there, mayor, he is elected, recently elections have taken place and so New York has elected Bloomberg, the Republican candidate. So that mayor is there. Now he looks upon himself as mayor, everybody else looks upon himself as mayor, that is okay, leave alone, everybody else looks upon him as mayor and he looks upon himself as mayor. Now, is he mayor till the other day? No. Today, what is he? Today, he is mayor. After his term is over, what he will be? He will not be a mayor. He will be a non-mayor. Therefore, this mayor is what? Is it an entity other than the person? No. The person is the reality and the person assumes something for himself and that is what he becomes as though. Once again, he doesn't really become. as though. So he becomes mayor by assuming himself to be mayor. You may say there is enough reason to assume like that. Yeah, that reason you keep it aside. There is a reason only. Here also we have enough reason to assume oneself as jiva. That reason is called avidya. Anyway, so there is enough reason to assume, but then he assumes himself to be a mayor and then he becomes a mayor. Does he really become a mayor? If he really becomes a mayor, then he will never become a non-mayor again. So he as though becomes a mayor and hence he becomes ex-mayor later. What is this mayor? It is just an assumption superimposed upon oneself. Everything is like that. There is an incidental reason for that assumption. That way it is. Anyway, this jiva, whatever jivatvam or limitations or the bundle of habits and limitations that he has superimposed upon himself, so that jiva, he resolves into that sat, and when he comes back, tada bhavanti, tadeva bhavanti, he comes back as the same jiva. That is with regard sleep. And with regard death, which is dirgha nidra, then whatever samskaras or desires, etc. he has, he goes along with them, with all those limitations and samskaras. The other day I told you, the samskara which is there very predominantly at the time of death, that will manufacture the next body for this person. So, whatever samskaras are there, he carries those samskaras with them and along with them he merges into Parameshwara after death. Having merged into Ishvara, he comes back. Everything through Ishvara. Like government transactions. Suppose you, in India we see these government transactions. Suppose I owe 10 rupees to government and the government owes me 12 rupees, suppose. Then they can give me 2 rupees, right? They won't do that. You pay 10 rupees first, unless you and get a no debt certificate. Okay, I will pay, take it. No, he won't take it. There is another place where he will take it. So, that place you search for it. It is supposed to be nearby this place? No. It is some at least 2 miles away in another area. So, go there and pay this 10 rupees. And ask him no debt certificate. No, he will not give no debt certificate. No debt certificate will be given by some other fellow. So go there. And this fellow will send a message. So this message will go there and he gives no debt certificate. And then bring it and give to this gentleman. He gives you 12 rupees. So only this way only the money should go into treasury. It should come from treasury. No question of intermingling in between. We will adjust. No. Similarly, the jiva goes into Ishvara and comes back from Ishvara. No question of you say Tata to Ishvara and get transformed here to here. It is not that way. So sada sampanna bhavati again comes back from Ishvara. The idea is he is never away from Ishvara. He need not travel in space to merge into Ishvara. He need not wait in time to merge into Ishvara. He is Ishvara. So anyway, so when the ajnana blossoms, he becomes a jiva. When the ajnana goes into sleep, he is Ishvara. We can see that every day in our life. Only we don't care to recognize it. In sleep, all limitations are gone. And in sleep, you are happy. For no reason. You tell me why you are happy in sleep. There is no reason for it. In daytime, if you are happy, you look very happy, what is the reason? Then he will say, today is my birth date, something he will say. So, whereas in sleep, he is happy for no reason. And he is refreshed for no reason, for no explanation. You can never give any explanation for it. And all the limitations are gone. In fact, what you imagine yourself to be, even that is gone. Anyway, I tell you, this sleep is a wonderful model which proves that you are limitless existence, absolute existence. So, in the Dirgha Nidra, he goes into Ishvara, that limitless existence, and comes back along with the same samskaras. And those samskaras which are embedded in the astral body will eventually manufacture a body, a physical body for this person. That is how it is. It may take some time. Whereas if you go to sleep, you come out in a few hours. If it is death, Dirghanidra, he will come back in a few days or months. If it is pralayam, then the time scale is bigger. In fact, Shankara mentions, yuga sahasra koti antaritapi. Even if hundreds of yugas, you see, Hindu time scale, Vedic time scale is a wonderful time scale. In fact, I always say this, when occasion demands, there are three time scales in this universe. One is geological time scale. If you go to Grand Canyon, you can see that there. The Vishnu Schist, 200 million years old. The rocks and the Brahma Schist, they call them Vishnu, Brahma, etc. I don't know how they call Grand Canyon in Arizona. It is not even in New York. New York is somewhat closer to India, whereas Grand Canyon is too far removed from India. And there, Vishnu Schist, Brahma, there is a Brahma temple. And you believe me, there is no Indian community there. Indian community, if they come together, they will put up a temple. And put a dozen shrines there. This is how Indian community functions. But then there is no Indian community there, not much. And yet they have a Brahma temple or whatever. Anyway, so a geological scale, time scale. It talks of time in terms of hundreds of millions of years. And then there is a cosmological scale, another time scale. The cosmologists, they talk of it, when the stars have taken birth, all that. Their time scale coincides with the geological time scale. If they don't coincide, then you can't call them scientific. They have to coincide, you know. So, cosmological time scale, about the universe, you know, when the universe was born and all that, it also talks of hundreds of millions of years. That is the language in which it speaks. The earth was born 200 million years ago, 500 million years ago, like that it talks. Then there is the Vedic time scale. It talks exact language, hundreds of millions of years. Here Shankara is talking the same time scale, yuga sahasra koti. Yuga sahasra, yuga is 432,000. That means how much it becomes? It becomes 0.432 million. Maybe or 43.2 million. Or maybe 4.32 million. Whatever the decimal you have to readjust. So I know it as 43,20,000 years. That is one yuga. Yuga is Mahayuga. 43,20,000. So 4320000. That is it. So 43,20 and 3 zeros besides that. That is one yuga. And yuga sahasra. 1,000 of such yugas. And koti. Into 1 crore. 1 crore is 10 million. Again it goes into that scale only. You know the theological scale. Theologians also have a scale. Some silly scale they have. So they say Ishvara created, God created this universe. When? 5,000 years back. That is the maximum he can go back, 5,000 years. And if you say, no, we have bones, the fossils, etc., which are 10 million years old or 100 million years old, then they say, God at the time of creating this universe 5,000 years ago, he has put those fossils also that way 5,000 years back only. That is how they say. Anyway, it is all a funny way of looking at it. These three time scales, they perfectly coincide. Very nice analysis in Vedanta we have. Anyway, even if a person, a jiva, goes into Ishvara and stays or abides in Ishvara for such millions of years, in pralaya. You know, srishti means the creation, it lasts for hundreds of millions of years. And when it is gone, that means when it goes into pralayam, pralayam is big crunch. then it remains in that big crunch for hundreds of millions of years. Because it is like day and night. Day is 12 hours, night is 12 hours, roughly. It may vary here and there, but roughly. Similarly, hundreds of millions of years creation, the period of creation, same period of annihilation will be there. Therefore, here is a jiva who went into Ishvara during that pralaya. Then there will be no manifestation or no birth as a jiva for hundreds of millions of years. And he will be in Ishvara. And he will come back in the next kalpa, we say next cycle of creation, which is called a kalpam. In that next kalpa, he again comes back. It is like one person sleeps 3 hours and wakes up. Another person sleeps 6 hours and wakes up. That is, only time scale is different. Otherwise, yad yad bhavanti tada bhavanti. Whatever they were before sleep, the same person will wake up after sleep. There will be no difference. That means in sleep and after death, and even if you go to Satyaloka, the seventh heaven, the seventh highest heaven, and stay there, one with Ishvara, for hundreds of millions of years in the time scale, still your ajnana will not be removed. Your ignorance will not be removed. It will be there. It will come back. It is like these seeds. Yesterday I was telling about pumpkin seed. So pumpkin season is how much? 1 or 2 months? So the pumpkin creeper comes up and it gives birth to a pumpkin fruit. And the whole thing is over in 3 months. And that seed sleeps for 9 months and then sprouts. The same thing. So its life's time is 3 months and its sleeping time is 9 months. Yet the samskara, the seed samskara, the bija samskara we call it, that is not lost, that is not obliterated. It remains and the same thing comes back. This is how, that's why Shankara has quoted, yathaprajnam hi sambhavaha, sambhavaha jivaha jayante iti jivaha, sambhavanti iti sambhavaha. So which take birth? The individuals who take birth. Yathaprajnam, that birth is determined by the prajna, the vasanas, the bundle of vasanas. They determine the birth. And they continue to be there till eternity unless he knows his swarupa. Only jnanam can destroy these vasanas. This is like that. Okay. So, saya esho nima. Therefore, this anima. Anima means anubhavaha. Means the sukshmatamam tatvam. The reality which is the subtlest entity. What do you mean by subtlest? It is the source from which everything arises. And everything resolves back. And what is this everything? All the different jivas with different properties, different sets of vasanas, all difference, all plurality. So all this plurality arises from that source which itself is non-plural. That is called anima. Anutvam is like that. For example, hands are different than legs. Hands are different, legs are different. Each has a different function. Each has a different name and a different form. But the source from which their strengths are derived, that prana, in that there is no difference. That is what is called anima. So in the subtle reality, all differences vanish. Yet it is the source of all differences. That is how we have to look at it. And so now, you are carried away by the differences, then you miss that reality, undifferentiated. So that anima means avyakta source, a source in which all these differences just do not exist, in spite of the fact that it is the source of all differences. Saya esho nima. And that awareness, that sat vijnanam, that awareful existence, absolute, that is the source of this entire universe. Aitadatmyam idam sarvam. Idam sarvam, all this has its source in that Brahman. So, here I would like to discuss some shastric concept. You see, we have a statement here, like sarvam kalvidam brahma. This is the similar statement. Aitadatmyam idam sarvam. That is mentioned here. In the same Upanishad, earlier, in the fourth adhyaya, so we have a statement called sarvam kalvidam brahma. That is from Chandogya fourth adhyaya. Sarvam kalvidam brahma. Tajjalaniti shanta upasita. Like that one upasana is there. So anyway, so sarvam kalvidam brahma. The statement has to be correctly understood. By now you know a little Sanskrit also. You see, we have what is called samanadhikaranyam. Means two words, two different words of course, they are in the same case ending. You know what is a case ending? Vibhakti. So, they are in the same case ending. In Sanskrit, we have these cases. So, noun is prathama vibhakti. If the same noun is used as an object, instead of subject, it is used as an object, then we call it dvitiya vibhakti, a second case, accusative case, etc. They call it nominative case, accusative case, like that. Then we have tritiya vibhakti, which is a karanartha, in the sense of a instrument. So in English it is by, in that sense it is used. Like that we have a few cases. You take the first case. So you have two words in the very first case, like Dasharathihi Ramaha. So Dasharathihi, son of Dasharatha. Ramaha, a gentleman by name Rama. Ramaha. So these are the two words. The son of Dasharatha is all merged into a single word, like that. So Dasharathihi Ramaha. When you have two such words, then what happens, both are related to the same entity. How do you know both are related to the same entity? Son of Dasharatha, Rama. So, son of Dasharatha, it refers to a person. Rama refers to a person. Now, both these words refer to two different persons or the same person? They refer to the same person. Why? Because both words occur in the same case ending. You followed that? So, Dasharathihi Ramaha. So, this way, two different words having different meanings. Meanings are different, you know. Vinna pravurti nimittav. So, different meanings are also different. Meanings are not same. Dasharathihi means son of Dasharatha. Ramaha means a gentleman. It's a name. So, both are different words, different meanings, but they point out the same entity. This kind of a thing is called samanadhikaranyam. This is Sanskrit grammar. In grammar, we analyze this syntax very thoroughly. And many Western grammarians and philologists, they say this syntax analysis is the most subtle thing in Panini's grammar. They agree to that. Anyway, so this is called samanadhikaranyam. Samana adhikarana bhava. Adhikarana is case ending. Samana, same. So that situation of having the same case ending is called samanadhikaranyam. It sounds very big, but its meaning is quite simple. So samanadhikaranya. This kind of samanadhikaranya, it has a few varieties in it. For example, when you refer to two adjectives of the same entity, you have samanadhikaranyam, like Dasharathihi Ramaha. There is a person, he is called Ramaha by name, therefore the word Ramaha refers to him. He happens to be the son of Dasharatha, therefore the word Dasharathihi also refers to him. Therefore you now have two words which function as adjectives or qualifications for the same entity. This is one kind of samanadhikaranya. You can also give Nilo Ghataha. You can say Ramaha as the substantive And Dasharatha hears the adjective, you can say that. I have tried to put both to an entity. You can take one of them as the entity, Kamaha as the entity. So you take this Nilo-ghataha, a blue pot. So, Nilaha is an object which is blue. Nilaha is not blue. It is an object which is blue. It is a noun, you know. In Sanskrit, nouns are adjectives. So, Nilaha is, in English, you just translate blue pot. In English, pot is noun, blue is adjective. In Sanskrit, Nilaha is noun, ghataha is also noun. And Nilaha serves the function of an adjective. A noun becomes an adjective to another noun. So, this is like that. Then, Nilo ghataha. Nilaha is a blue object. Ghataha is a substantive. Now, both are in samanadhikarana. Both occur in the same case ending. Suppose you see in a statement, Nilaha in one corner, ghataha in another corner, jumbled words, you know. Then you pick up this Nilaha and make it an adjective to that ghataha. Because they happen to be in the same case ending. That case ending is the pointer. Wherever the word is, I will pick it up and make it adjective. You cannot miss it. Suppose in a given statement you have Nilasya in one place, Ghataha in some other place. Then this Nilasya is a Shashti, sixth case ending. It has nothing to do with Ghataha. You just forget about it. They don't combine together because the case endings are different. So this way, this Samanadhikaranyam plays an important role. So this Nilo Ghataha, it is called Visheshana Visheshya Bhava Samanadhikaranyam. Means a same case ending situation, Samanadhikaranyam, in which one word happens to be the adjective and the other word the Visheshya, the substantive. That is one kind of Samanadhikaranya. Right? But here we are not talking of that Samanadhikaranya. Idam Sarvam Khalvidam Brahma. Khalu you keep it aside. Khalu is an indeclinable. So Sarvam Brahma. Sarvam is everything. Brahma is that Sat, undifferentiated existence absolute. Now both have same case ending. Okay? Now if you look at it from that Nilo Ghataha situation, then what happens, you know? Sarvam becomes an adjective to Brahma. And therefore, Sarvam continues to exist in Brahma forever because it's an adjective. Nirogataha, a blue pot, the pot is blue. While you are relating to pot, simultaneously you are relating to the blueness also. Blueness is as real as pot. Adjective is also real. Quality is also there. The one which is qualified, that is also there. Both have same order of reality. That is called Visheshana Visheshya Bhava Samanadhikaranyam. But not here so. Here it is different. By the time you know Brahman, the Sarvam, Sarvam is plurality of the world, which is Jagat, which is Vishvam. Vishvam means Sarvam. Vividham Shvayati Gichyate Iti Vishvam. It appears to be many in different forms and names and all that. Therefore, when you say Sarvam Brahma, the Sarvam cannot be an adjective to Brahma because the Sarvam is unreal. Brahma is real. How unreal can be adjective to Brahma? No. Therefore, this should not be misunderstood as Visheshana Visheshya Bhava Rupa Samanadhikaranyam. We have a special kind of Samanadhikaranya for this. This is called Badhayam Samanadhikaranyam. This Badha. Badha is not pain. Generally, people think that Badha is pain. There is no pain involved here. This Badha is negation. It's a negation-based Samanadhikaranya. How I tell you? We first understand the illustration, then come to this vakya, which is an easy thing afterwards. You see, I am going for a walk in the semi-darkness of the evening, and I see a post and take it to be a person. In fact, by the time I take the post to be a person, now that he is not a simple person also. He is a thief because there is fear in you. There is the fear is a fear shows a snake on a rope, and it shows a thief or a mugger on a post. This is what the fear does. So I see the post and take it as thief. So now I make a statement. Choraha, like that. Choraha means thief. Then there is another person who goes that way daily for a walk. He has also mistaken it that way about that post. But later he discovered that it is not a thief. It stands there permanently. It is a post. So he is wiser to that. Therefore he says to that, you know what he says to him? Yash choraha sasthanuhu. That is what he says. Means what you take to be a thief is indeed a post. That is the entire statement. Now I condense that statement. Yaha choraha, what is a thief, saha sthanuhu. That is post. Made it simple. Now let me make it even simpler. Choraha sthanuhu. Right? So the thief is indeed a post. Forget about that indeed. Choraha sthanuhu. The thief is the post. That is the vakyam. You see, vakyam, I made a bigger statement first so that you understand it clearly. Then having made that statement, I made it smaller and smaller, and finally I left with two words only because I am interested in the case endings. The big statement can stay there, no problem. But this choraha is the first case ending, sthanuhu is first case ending. I pick them up and bring them together. Right? Whether you have a longer statement or you have shortened it, doesn't matter. These two words are there. Choraha, sthanuhu. When I say choraha, I am referring to a given object. When I say sthanuhu, I am referring to the same object. Two different words, choraha, sthanuhu. Two different meanings. Choraha is thief, sthanuhu is post. But the object referred to by both of them is the same. And both are same case endings. This is samanadhikaranya. But in this samanadhikaranya, is chora a quality of the post? No. Chora is not the quality of the post. Then what is this samanadhikaranya? It is not like Nilokataha, not like Dasharathihi Ramaha. It is a very interesting samanadhikaranya. The samanadhikaranya is, you look at it as chora, sublate it by knowledge, because it is wrong, and understand the reality. This is called badha. Badha means sublating the mistaken thing and understanding the reality. That is badha. And so, choraha sthanuhu, my God, what I take to be chora is indeed sthanu. So, while making that statement, he is sublating the unreal and understanding the real. This is called badhayam. Samanadhikaranyam. What is taken to be as a thief is indeed the post. That is the meaning of that vakyam, samanadhikaranyam. The samanadhikaranyam means the situation in which two words are presented in the same case ending has got this badha included in it. The sublation is a part of it. You need not make any statement for sublation later. You may explain it. So when I say the chora is the post, the thief is the post, that means that statement is self-explanatory by virtue of those case endings. Namely, what I have mistaken to be chora or a thief is indeed the post. Now, you go to a world of ornaments and say, all these ornaments are gold. All these ornaments, same case ending, gold, same case ending, R, don't bother about it. So all these ornaments, gold. It is badhayam samanadhikaranya. It means, what I take to be the plurality of ornaments, ornament is name and form, is indeed one non-dual gold. That is badhayam samanadhikaranya. You understood that? Now you come to sarvam khalvidam brahma. Sarvam is brahma. What I take to be many or plural in terms of the names and forms, it is not really plural. They are not many. It is indeed one. And that one, that non-dual thing is Brahman. Therefore, when I say sarvam khalu idam brahma, by the time I said sarvam and I am uttering khalu, I am already sublating it. Well, like even I say sthanuhu chauraha sthanuhu, while saying it I am sublating and arriving at the reality. Otherwise I cannot make a statement like that. Therefore, that's why there is a wonder. And so the hands are said, like all these things are an expression of that sublation which is taking place in the mind. All these ornaments are indeed gold. All these waves are indeed water. All these objects is what? Plurality. All this plurality, you see, the plural thing is a funny thing it is. You can present it as plural or you can present it as singular. If you say many, it is plural. If you say plurality, now it is what? It is singular. Thing remains what it is. So, language only. So, all this plurality is indeed, it is an expression of the sublation which is taking place by understanding. He understands, my God, now he knows it. So, that's why that knowing is said in terms of indeed. All this is indeed Brahman. That is the thing called, so keep this thing in mind. Badhayam samanadhikaranyam. Badhayam, it is Saptami Vibhakti. As the sublation is taking place, badhayam satyam, sati saptami they call it. As the sublation is taking place, samanadhikaranyam. What is sublated and what is the result of sublation? The end result of sublation, or we even call it the culmination of sublation. By the time you sublate, it culminates into the reality. So that culmination of the sublation, both are presented in the same case ending. This is the analysis of sarvam khalvidam brahma. That is the meaning of sarvam khalvidam brahma. You cannot have sarvam while having Brahman. And if you have sarvam, then there is no Brahman. So that's why we analyze it like that. It's not some grammar struggle. It is a struggle to understand the thing. Sarvam khalvidam brahma. Only a person who can, in his wisdom, sublate the plurality and sees through the plurality. Oh, this is looks like plural. It is not plural. And then he can reach the final truth. Aitadatmya midagum sarvam. This is the meaning of it. Sa Atma, that happens to be Atma. Don't take yourself to be some individual. You happen to be the ocean of consciousness in which everything happens. Everything is Jagat. Jagat is not every object, it is just a number of events only. So you should realize that you are the ocean of consciousness in which everything happens. You should not take yourself to be a particular phenomenon called this body or this life. This lifespan of, say, a few years, that is not you. You are, suppose I tell you, are you not seeing the world of plurality? You are seeing. Where is this world of plurality existing? It is existing in your consciousness. Can you tell me an object which is outside your consciousness? No. Therefore, the entire world exists in your consciousness. Then this body exists where? In the same consciousness. Then this life, same consciousness, this person, same consciousness. In the absence of that consciousness, you will not even know of that person. Therefore, you are that ocean where the time is appearing, in the same consciousness. Where from the space arises, space originates, same consciousness. Therefore, you are that ocean of consciousness in which everything, including this life, appears. You are not what appears. You are the source of what all appears. You have to realize this truth. It is not difficult at all. It only requires a little attentiveness. That is all it requires. Only thing is, you should take care that you are not carried away by an image of yourself, because image is unreal. The reality of image is the light in which the image appears. Image is unreal. It is not real. Therefore, you have to observe care attentively, and you have to look closely at yourself. And then you will realize that there is no event outside me, the consciousness. There is no event. Every event. Suppose a star is taking birth. That event is in me, the consciousness. Everywhere. Problem is, you should not, a star is there, I am here. That mistake you should not do. You are not here. This is in you. You are not here. If you are here, that can be in you? There is no antara and bahya. Therefore, you are that ocean of consciousness. You see, when you say, I am, that I is always referred to a limited individual, and that I is taken to be a jiva. I am is correct in the sense that it declares itself to be a conscious presence. To that extent it is correct. But the meaning given to I in I am is wrong. You have to do a little investigation. In fact, I tell you, you have to go through the entire field of investigation. A lot of effort you have to put in to investigate that. And finally, you should go beyond this investigation also. And for that, a teacher is required. A right teacher, a right teaching is required. Unless you do that, that the understanding that you have of I in I am, that false understanding can never be rectified. That's why a teacher is required, because you cannot figure it out. Because you see, it is the I of that I am who wields these means of knowledge like perception and inference. So they are instrument in his hands, they are like tongs in his hands. So I hold the tongs cannot hold me back. Similarly, the I holds and wields these pramanas called inference and perception. So, the meaning of I can never be appreciated by inference and perception. Not only that, if you try to know about I by inference and perception, you will end up in a wrong understanding. That is what you do all the time. Therefore, you should not try to gauge I with your own perception and inference. You need a pramana, a means of knowledge, and that is the teaching. So the teacher and teaching. Teacher is not an individual. One should not take teacher as an individual. I'll ask you a question. Is a teacher different from the teaching? No. Teacher is not hands and legs. A fellow walks here and there. That is not the teacher. Or who takes breakfast and lunch. That is not the teacher. Teacher is what? Teaching is the teacher, right? And then, teaching, suppose it remains outside of you, that means it doesn't make any impact upon you. That means it just fails to enter into your skull. Then, do you call it teaching? It is not teaching. It is some blabbering going on. It is like, I travel in Lufthansa. And so, she makes announcements after announcements. Is it a message given to me? No. I have nothing to do with it. Because this is German announcements, I can't make anything out of it. So, I don't call it any message or any indication given to me. As far as I am concerned, it is not an indication. It is not an instructions to the passengers. Pilot says, now, please listen carefully. We are providing some instructions to the passengers. And so that is what pilot says. And she gives instructions. I am not concerned with any of these things, because I don't know the language. Therefore, teaching, as long as it remains outside this perimeter, it has no relevance to me. It is not teaching. Therefore, it has to be known to me. Now, where is the teacher? in you. Buddhi is the teacher. In fact, I tell you, Atma is the teacher. Ishvaro Guru Ratmeti Murti Bheda Vibhagine. Your higher self is your teacher. Your base self is the student, if he is wise. If he is not wise, then he is not even a student. Therefore, that's why Ishvaro Guru Ratmeti. If your prarabdha is good, then Ishvara appears as Guru. And if the prarabdha continues in the same good line, then the Guru appears as Jnanam. Ishvaro Guru Ratmeti. Jnanam is Atma, and Jnanam is not outside Atma. Ishvaro Guru Ratmeti Murti Bheda Vibhagine. Therefore, it has to go through this process, and one has to recognize the higher truth. So, that way only you should try to know I. Till then, you don't come to any conclusion about this I. In fact, so sa atma tattvamasi. This tattvamasi is the one which I am talking about. So that infinite consciousness, it happens to be you. I mean, you happen to be that. And so, you have to appreciate that fact. You see, it is easy and also it is difficult. I tell you how. I give you a model. You see, a child is born. Now the child is months old baby. The child, does it know any words? Even mom, pop, papa, etc. Does it know? No. It doesn't know anything except making meaningless sounds or crying. What it knows? It knows nothing. Now, will you stop talking with that child? Because, you know, generally it is understood, if you have to talk with a person, he has to know the language. Your language he should know. Then only you talk with the other person, right? That is the fundamental thing it is. Now the child, months old baby, he doesn't know the language. And suppose he doesn't know the language. Suppose you say flower in English. I don't know English language. I may not be able to understand flower. The word flower I may not be understand. But if you show me this and say flower, 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 like that if you say, then I understand. Why? Because the object is known at least to me. If not the language, the object is known. What about the child? The child neither knows the objects nor the language. Child doesn't know that it is a flower. Child sees it. It holds it, but doesn't know that it is a flower. Right? So the child doesn't know objects. The child doesn't know language. Now what you do? You will wait till the child picks up the language and picks up the knowledge of objects and then only you talk with the child? No. So, you see, this language and the knowledge of objects, let us give a name to it. It is called local consciousness. Right? Consciousness, that is what it is, really. You can call it even more Vedantically. So, samsara consciousness. You are in samsara and you are very desperate, you are anxiously waiting for the child also to come into that samsara. Right? That's why parents, when their children, they don't want to tread the same path of samsara that they have tread, so they are very unhappy. The father is a doctor and his son wants to do a course in camera course. There is a course on camera also, camera or photography. The father is desperate. What is going on? He never knew that there is a course in photography. Now he was hoping that his son will become a doctor. Okay, if that is not possible, at least he should become an engineer. What is this photography course? But then the son wants to become that. Anyway, you see, the child is not into the samsara consciousness. Whereas we are all already in that consciousness. So what we do? We help the child to grow into the local consciousness. So, the father calls the father smiles and calls the child, come here, he says. The child doesn't know what is this, come here. And then he smiles and extends his hands. Now the child understands just a little. So, that ragadvesha samskaras are there in the child from earlier life. Don't think that they are in this life. This, if you can look at it a bit closely, you can understand that the rebirth is a certainty. Otherwise, if you smile and extend hands, the child may run away. Why should come near you? Because that ragadvesha samskaras are there in the child already. You see, I went, a child was lying down in a cradle. And so somebody asked me, Swamiji, you please bless the child and put some akshatas in my hand, some rice, so uncooked rice. So I went and I wanted to bless the child and I looked into the face of the child. Just the first time I looked, I don't know who is this child and all, first time I am looking. It is a 5 months old baby. And so even the parents do not know the child much. So I looked and then the child smiled. I was stunned. Why this child is smiling at me? Probably this color, etc. is a bit unusual. And so it liked that color and it smiled. Then I thought, oh, this is Purva Janma Samskara. Some samskara. I can't explain what is that samskara. But there is some samskara. So it sees a color. That is all it can see, no? It doesn't see a sadhu, etc. A color only it sees. Somehow that color, it has got a samskara of liking. It is possible some other child is afraid. It is possible. Therefore, anyway, coming to the point, the child is ignorant of local consciousness. But the parents, so they teach, they help the child to grow into local consciousness. Like saying, come here, smiling, and saying, mom, mom, I am the mom, mom, like that a dozen times. So, papa, papa, like that. Then slowly, the child learns and grows into local consciousness. Right? Now, the same thing we have to do with reference to the consciousness called Brahman, Brahma consciousness. That is all you have to do. So you are like a spiritual babe. You think all this plurality is real the way it looks, which is wrong. And so all this plurality is a superimposition. And you should raise to that divinity consciousness, or let me say God consciousness. What is that? God is Brahman. So, that God consciousness, you have to grow into it. And you don't know that it is all God's manifestation. You have some funny ideas about God, or you don't know what God at all. And then you know that I am is known to you, and that I happens to be a limited individual, as you know it, the way you know it now. So from this is samsara consciousness. I am a limited individual and the world in which I live is different from me and it is plural and it is ragadvesha, it is likes and dislikes. This is samsara consciousness, a very bad, it's a very unreal consciousness. Let me not say bad, it is unreal. The God consciousness is, this entire universe of its plurality is a superimposition on that Sachidananda Brahma, which is awareness, purna, and that happens to be me. That is God consciousness. And you have to grow into that. Sa atma tatvamasi shveta keto. That shveta keto address means that, my dear son, he is mom. Like mom says, dear son, he is papa. And he refuses to understand it. And refuses to understand, recognize this papa. Then mom says, na tandri, my dear son. He is your papa. Like that he helps him to grow into that consciousness. And she does it a dozen times, then he says papa. Similarly, he shveta keto, you have to grow. Tattvamasi, you are not what you think yourself to be. You are that infinite consciousness which is God and you are that. And you grow into it. It takes a while to grow into it. So like even the child takes a while to grow into local consciousness, the same way the spiritual babe who takes himself to be an individual, limited, so he takes a while to grow into that God consciousness. How to grow? You have to do Shravana Manana Nididhyasana and you have to live in the company of Mahatmas who have that God consciousness. Suppose the Mahatma doesn't have the God consciousness, he is a samsara conscious. You live in his company, nothing happens. Only you get more of the samsara. So, you have to, any number of disciplines can be followed, but basically the acharya, the place, the people, the environment, the values, every one of them should be conducive to raise into that God consciousness. Then you will slowly rise and you will appreciate that truth. Till then, you are not supposed to make any judgment about yourself. And the mind tries to make judgments, and you have to fight against that tendency of the mind to make judgments about oneself, because you happen to be that tattvamasi shvetaketo. So you see, in the immensity of consciousness or awareness, a tiny point rises, and this tiny point, it goes on moving, and the movement of this tiny disturbance, it creates and recreates this whole world, and that tiny point is called I am. There is no world other than the movement of the tiny point I am. And that I am also is not what it appears to be. Its reality is the consciousness from which it has arisen. If this I am tiny point, it stops moving, then there is no world. It moves, the world is created, which only shows that the world doesn't exist outside me, the consciousness. And so, you first look within and you find that the point of light, the tiny point of consciousness that I am, is not indeed the source. It is only a reflection of the source. Because when you look inward and try to recognize that I am, try to abide in that I am being what it is, because it is a reflection, it starts dissolving. And while it is dissolved, if it is the final source, it should not dissolve, it should remain and it should be strengthened by your abiding in it. But what happens is, as you try to abide in I am, as you try to be with the sense of I am, the sense of I am slowly, it dissolves. And you find yourself one with that awareness in which there is no I am. Therefore, in this way, you can recognize that this sense of I am is nothing but a reflection of that immensity of awareness or infinite awareness in this body-mind-sense complex. Then you can recognize this as the apparatus. Oh, this I am is just a reflection in this apparatus. Once you recognize that, then you are in that Brahman. Therefore, that alone is that tattvamasi, that infinite awareness alone is. Everything else appears. In that is sat, infinite awareness, I am is the first stirring. And that I am, it continues to create a world. This is the procedure. Therefore, what you are not the world which appears. Body is the world, that's why I say. You are not that sense of I am also, because it happens to be a reflection. It is better in the sense that it is better than getting confined to a physical body. So, you are that source which is reflecting in this psychosomatic apparatus. The reality of a reflection of sun in a dewdrop is not the reflection itself. It is the sun. From the sun, that reflection comes, and into that sun, this reflection merges. Therefore, in that awareness, by the time you merge into that awareness, by the time you stay in I am, the whole world resolves into I am. And by the time the I am itself resolves, so you abide in that awareness, and that in that awareness, there is no plurality, there is no time, there is no space, there is no seer and seen division, subject-object division is not there. It is one single monolithic, homogeneous, non-dual block of cognition. Vijnanam Brahma Tattvamasi. That happens to be you, Shvetaketo. This is how he was addressed by the teacher. So, he has still some more doubts. We look into it. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha
हरि ओम तत्सत श्री कृष्णार्पणमस्तु।